All right, then, if you have your Bibles, for 2 Corinthians chapter 6, beginning in verse 11, the Bible says, O ye Corinthians, our mouth is open unto you, our heart is enlarged. You're not straitened in us, but ye are straitened in your own bowels. Now, for recompensing the same, I speak unto my children, be ye also enlarged. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they will be my people. Wherefore, come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercy and grace. Lord, we praise you for saving our souls, Lord, and for placing you in your church. Lord, we give you the praise for that. Lord, tonight we pray that you would bless your word. You've promised us that it would not return unto you void, Lord, and we pray that you would accomplish things with it tonight for your glory and your honor. Be with each of us that are here, Lord. We pray that you would stir us up by the Holy Spirit, Lord, and we pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, very familiar verses of Scripture. I'm not convinced that sometimes we don't miss the mark what this teaching is really just about. But the sum of the whole matter is this, is how close do you want to be to the Lord? How near do you want to be with Him? And how much are you okay with being in the way? Now, we know that there's no obstacle too great because the Bible says this, ye draw nigh unto me, and I will draw nigh unto you. So, it's nothing that can't be overcome, but it is things that do get in the way. Now, verse 11, and this is Paul's second letter to the Corinthian church. The first one was pretty scathing. He had really had to tell them what was wrong, and they had so much sin in the church that they had a man that I'm assuming he was fooling around with his stepmother. And they were okay with that. They weren't saying it. They weren't addressing it. You know, the problem with many of our churches today, we know there's a problem, and we're afraid of losing members or losing money, and the problems are not addressed. You know what? We should be well satisfied. Well, if that's the way it is, you know what? If we have to meet in the front room with my double wide, that'll be okay too. Amen. But you don't see that anymore. They want to walk around things. So Paul had really sent them a very scathing letter, and I want you to see the response. Oh, ye Corinthians, our mouth is open unto you, our heart is enlarged. Now, I want you to notice two things. His heart was enlarged. He loved them. Now, a lot of people, sometimes in my preaching, they probably think maybe I'm angry. You know why I preach the truth and stick to the Word of God when even it's difficult? It's because I love you. If I sugarcoated it, it might say good for a while. It might seem kind, but down the road, there would be great problems. So you must preach it as it is. Plus nothing, minus nothing. So he loved them. That's the reason he did what he did. He was concerned, my heart's enlarged for you. And then I also want you to see, but he did say this, my mouth's open to you. I am going to tell you. I'm going to remind you once again. I'm going to tell you some things that may not be too palatable. My mouth is open. And we need to do that. Verse 12 says, ye are not straitened in us, but you're straitened in your own bowels. Now, a lot of people kind of get confused there. First of all, let me say concerning what people believed about the innermost part of man in that day, they thought the center of man was right here. And he says, you're not straightened. I didn't do it, but you did it yourself. Now, when he said that, he didn't mean they cleaned up on their own, but because they were redeemed, the center of them had been saved, the soul man had been redeemed, they were able to straighten yourselves out. Now, if you're satisfied with the filth of this world, listen, you're not straightened. You're just not straightened. And we'll get into a number of things tonight. We think about all that goes with that. Women running around like men and men running around like women. And all that's very true. But you know what? Just being spiteful. And ladies, I don't want to jump on y'all because men are just as bad. But there's a lot about backbiting ladies in this book. The Bible says they're talebearers. Silly women going from house to house. You know what? That ought not to be among God's people. You know what? So we see then that Paul is very forthright with them. He says, you're straightened because of the goodness of God. Verse 13, now for recompense in the same, I speak as unto children, be ye also enlarged. And he said, I'm going to send you some more recompense. I'm going to send you some correction like children. I want you enlarged. I want you to grow. That enlarged, he didn't want a bunch of fat people down at the church at Corinth. He wanted mature Christian people. And you know what? We need to see growth over the years. We need to be able to get to the point where we set some things. You know what? There shouldn't be a person under the sound of my voice that's set under my ministry for the years that you have that can't open that book and show me why we believe God foreknew a people before the world began. That is being trained in the truth of the Word of God. And so he said, I'm telling you this for your benefit. I want you enlarged. I want you developed. I want you strong in the faith. That's what he was saying to them. Then I want you to see verse 14. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, there are as many yokes as you can think about. Marriage is a yoke, people. Be very careful with it. It is a yoke. When you make those vows, you better mean them. When you say, I will and I do, it's to death do you part.
Amen.
Now, I won't get a great deal into ceremonies tonight, but you are making a promise. And it better be one that you're willing to keep for the rest of your life. Because you know what? You're there, whether you want to say in your mind you are or you're not, you're still co-joined throughout the very end. And so be sure you select your mate very carefully. Now, another thing that you need to be very, very careful about is lodges such as the Oddfellows Club, the Woodmen of America, and they are a different type of people. A lot of people just say, that's just an organization. Well, you go deeper than that, and you'll find different. The Masons, all they are a bunch of Baalists. They go right back to the Temple of Babel. And so we need to be very, very cautious because when you join up, you're one of them. Yeah, you've entered in contract. You've entered with them. And listen, we need to be able, the type of the people, to say, listen, I'm not going to do that. Even down to the place where you work. You need to be sure that you're okay with that. You know what? Very recently, the Lord's been troubling me about this. So finally, I just laid it out there. I enjoy my job. I like teaching nursing. One reason I like to teach it, I'm going to be old soon, and those folks are going to be caring for me. And I don't want a bunch of stupid nurses trying to care for me. I want smart nurses. And so we see that. But I got to the point where it was so difficult for me to get off that I could not even go and preach like I wanted to. So I wrote my supervisor and said, listen, I mean this with all kinds of respect, but if I can't get off to preach, you're going to have to find someone else to do it. I wasn't threatening her. She's very nice. Her and her supervisor as well. But I wasn't doing it to be threatening, but first things have to come first.
Amen.
And you know what? I'm not going hungry yet. I don't think I ever will. I claim that by the Word of God. And so we see then that Paul wanted them to understand that we don't need to be hooked up with people who do not believe the Bible. Being unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship have righteousness with unrighteousness? Now, a lot of people jump over that and say, well, they don't have any. sometimes they do. You know what? If you can go to work and all they're ever talking about is a ball game, what kind of fellowship is that? It's stupid. You know, I don't get down on people who watch sports all the time, but I will say this, it's a waste of time. It really is. I don't mean that critically. But when you could be praying for, you know, and it's equally as bad, and I'm just using that as an example because that's what you find men talking about a lot of times. I waste a lot of time on the internet looking for things about dead people that have been dead for 200 years. That, you know, that is a waste of time. And we really need to understand that. But when it comes down to fellowship, if you can get along with these people at work and everything be just hunky-dory, something is wrong. You know what? When they say foul, gross things, we ought to be disgusted by it. But little by little by little, it will send your spirit to a high to when they say it, you don't even flinch. And so we need to be very cautious. We need to be very careful about what we allow to go on and what we allow ourselves. So you think about when you arrive at work, what kind of fellowship are you going to have? Then what she says, and what communion have light with darkness? And what concord have Christ with Belial? Now he kind of changes it, and he trying to make us understand our own answer. What kind of fellowship does Christ have with Baal or Belial? None. They're total opposite. One is the mighty Son of God, and one is an idol. There's nothing there. They're as far as east from the west. And that's how it should be from us. We should not have good fellowship with people who do not love Christ. That do not enjoy truth, that do not enjoy the things of God. We shouldn't have fellowship or desire fellowship in those types of situations, but very frequently we do. What agreement have the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. Now, if you are saved tonight, you remember this, ye are the temple of the living God. He says, I do not dwell in temples made by hand, but I dwell in you. And so this evening, as you begin to think and contemplate that, where are you dragging the person of Christ? Because you are. You're taking him somewhere. You know, President Trump's in Nashville tonight, and now I was talking about, and they took him to the municipal auditorium. And all I said is, I hope it looked better than it did in the 80s, because when I went to concerts there in the 80s, it's about to cave in then. But you know what? As I was thinking about that, it occurred to me, you know what? I took Christ there with me. The concerts that I listened to shouldn't have never even been there. I will say this, and it's not an excuse, but it's why I preach it today. No one ever even told me that was wrong. Yeah. And you know why? Because very few people would preach it then, and almost nobody preaches it today.
Right.
I have no business going down there and listening to Motley Crue, but I had no idea it was wrong. Nobody ever told me, and I shouldn't have been there. I'm not trying to get out of it, so to speak. But I'm just saying, if we don't teach these little ones, who's going to? And I'll say the world will. If you won't teach them, the world will. And so we see then that Paul says, listen, we don't have any fellowship with these people. Then notice what it says. For ye are the temple of the living God, as God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Wherefore, because we have this fellowship, because he is within us, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord. Now, we are to be a set. That word means exactly what it says. If you took a piece of paper like this and rip it in two halves, it's separated, right? No longer together. Can't be restored. Shouldn't be put back together. Now, that is where we need to be as the Lord's people tonight, is we need to be tore away from this world. Now, a lot of times it's painful. A lot of times it's difficult. You just have to kind of let so-called friendships go and let them go. You don't need them. We need to be a separated people. And you know why we need to be a separated people? A separated church is a powerful church. It's a church that's useful and lent to the service of God. And a worldly church laden down with worldly stuff is useless as a three-legged horse. We need to be separated because we desire the closeness and the power of God. And you don't see that today. You don't see a lot of interest in people wanting to be more separate in the things of the Lord. Now, go with me back to 1 Corinthians. And again, the first one a little bit more scathing than the second one. But 1 Corinthians 11, I want to touch on a couple of things there. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 8. He begins off and he's talking about the headship order up to here. And whether we like it or not, the man is the head of the home. And if you want to let your wife run things around, you can do it. But let me say this, you'll still be held accountable in front of an almighty God. You let her run the house, but listen, she's not answering for it, you are. Amen. So if she does a really poor job, it's not her problem, it's yours. And so we see then that he makes it very, very plain in the first part of that chapter how the home should be outlined. And then in verse 8 he says, "For the man is not of the woman, but the woman of the man. The reason why I am Donna's head is because she was made, woman was made from man and not the other way around. They are, and not that they aren't good people, it's just the headship order. Verse 9, neither was man created for the woman, but the woman for the man. For this cause ought the woman to have power on her head because of the angels." Now, I'll give you a couple of thoughts on that. That power means authority, or submission, or under. There's a lot of ways that could be interpreted. But look at the context of the scriptures. He says, she'll have power. She has something to represent that she's under. That she is in subjection. And then it says, why? Because of the angels. Now, at one time, my daughters wore their head covering all the time. And as I was studying, because I wanted it to be right, I didn't want to pick up things what other people had told me. But if you read that, what does the Bible say in the Revelation part of the church letters? To the angel of the church at Thyatira, I write. And you know what? That's not an angelic being. That's a pastor or a preacher.
Right.
And so a woman is to wear a head covering to respect the man of God while he's preaching.
Amen.
That is the truth of the head covering. And I'm not trying to cram it down nobody's throat. I'm just saying that when we consider the woman and we consider the man and we consider the framework of the home, it has to be addressed. Now we'll go a little further. For this cause of the woman to have power or authority on her head because of the angels or the pastors. Nevertheless, neither is the man without the woman, neither the woman without the man in the Lord. We have to come as a package together. We create a testimony together, one with the other, when we come as we should. Verse 12. For as the woman is of the man, so is the man also by the woman, but all things of God. Judging yourselves, is it comely that a woman pray unto God uncovered? Is it right? Is it just? Is it the way it should be? Doth not nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him? Now, we get into a whole different issue here. And man, I've heard some good sermons over the years on man wearing long hair, haven't you? But how many of you heard about women wearing long hair? How many of you heard about a woman butchering hers off? Because you can't preach one without preaching the other. Is that right? One has to be just as bad as the other. And it all gets back to headship. You know why I like my hair long? It's because I like everybody to look at it. It was unusual, and I wanted to be noticed. I wanted to look different. And you know why women get their hair butched off up like mine? It's because they want to be noticed, and they sure don't want to be under the headship of nobody. Yeah. That is that teaching. And it's not real pleasant. It's not one of those, woo! But the thing of it is, it's the truth. It is what the Bible teaches. And so we see there that Paul was very specific on how things should be. How this should be ordered. Well, doeth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him. But if a woman have long hair, it is a glory to her, for her hair is given her for covering. Now, it didn't say that it was to stand in for, it was given to her for a covering. Just like my body is given me for clothes. I don't run around naked. Verse 16, but if a man seem to be contentious or upset or division, we have no such custom. In other words, don't have a fight over it. Do I believe it? Yeah, you better believe it. I'll preach it. Lord be my helper. Unless he never convinces me of something different, I'll preach it to the day I die. But I'm not upset with those who don't believe it. You know what? I will pray for them. I will put them before the Lord. I will say, have you considered? And more so than the external covering, women who run around with their hair bobbed off, you know what? That's where I'd start, wouldn't it be you? I mean, if the covering, you know, they're not going to get the external covering if they don't even know what this is about. And so that ought to be something that we're willing to teach and preach. And so we see today that very quickly slipping away. And I'll give you a challenge to look into this. Go find you a picture of a church group before 1950, and look at the women. That's my only challenge for you. You go do that, and you'll find something very unusual. Look with me in 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter number 2. Verse 7. Consider what I say, and the Lord give thee understanding in all things. Remember that Jesus Christ of the seed. That's still not the verse I want to read. Look with me in 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 8. 1 Timothy chapter. We'll do 1 Timothy 2, 7 first. 1 Timothy 2, 7. Whereunto I am ordained a preacher and an apostle, I speak the truth of Christ. Now, Paul is writing to young Timothy and wanting Timothy to express to the church in Ephesus these things. He says, I am ordained a preacher and an apostle. Two separate offices, two separate things to do, two separate ordinations, if you will. He says, I speak the truth in Christ. And why not? A teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity. I will therefore that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. Now I want you to notice a couple things concerning prayer. He says, I want men to pray everywhere. I want them to pray in the assembly. I want them to pray out there on the road. I want them to pray in their homes. I would that men pray everywhere with their hands lifted. Now, if I said, blessed be the name of the Lord, most people would think they walked in on a Pentecostal service. Right? But that is what the Bible says, right? We can't take a portion of what the Word of God says and say, oh, that's good teaching.
You know what? We're to lift holy hands. If we want to pray, it's fine to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Lift them hands up. It's nothing wrong with it. I would that men pray everywhere. I want them to pray everywhere. That's what he was saying. I want them to pray in every place. I want them to pray wherever they're at. I will therefore that man pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. Now I will say this, wrathful prayers, angry prayers will come home to you. You don't ever pray in anger. Don't pray that somebody's going to be snuffed out of the way. That don't ever have an angry prayer like that. But then I also want you to say, without wrath, and we'll amen that, without wrath and doubting. Don't you pray in doubt. You pray in belief. You pray with the thought that it's as good as done. Now, that's one weakness I've seen among Sovereign Grace Baptists, is the prayer life. And I'll throw me in with that group. Because, well, God's sovereign. It's just going to be that way anyway, so whatever. Then why does he desire to hear our prayers? That don't even make sense, does it? Is he going to do what he's going to do? Sure. But you know what? He is well pleased when we ask him.
Amen.
He shows our dependence on him. And you know what? Half the time, we don't need to be sending a wish list anyway. All we need to be is saying, blessed be the name of the Lord. Our great God Jehovah is above all and in all and through all, and the Lord Jesus Christ sits beside him high on the throne. He's marvelous and great, and everything is under his feet. You know what? You don't have to ask for nothing. In fact, the Bible says, I think the Lord Jesus Christ is on that street, said, I know what things you have need of. He said that. So he understands and knows. So when we begin to pray, be sure that we're in a situation, in a prayerful situation. Verse 9, in like manner, on the same token, in the same way, in like manner also that the women adorn themselves in modest apparel. First of all, I want you to see whatever women wear, it's got to be modest. You know what? And we'll get into that in a minute and why I believe that. Because, first of all, nobody would come in here wearing a pair of, the ladies that are here tonight would not come in here wearing a tight pair of breeches, because you've heard it all your life. But you know what? I've seen some skirts where they probably would have been more modest in a pair of breeches, hadn't you? You know what, ladies, if the skirt, you have to do this to sit down in it, it's probably too short. And you know what, ladies, the skirts don't lengthen out just because you pull on them. Right? That they're still this long, and you pull and pull and pull, and you ain't that strong, they're still going to be that long. And if you have to pull on them, something's wrong. And so we see then, as the Lord's people, first of all, that thing for the ladies, whether whatever it's going to be, it needs to be modest. The blouses don't need to be tight. The skirt don't need to be short. The breeches don't need to be tight. It must be a modesty. That's the first thing. Whatever you put on, it needs to be modest. And then it says, with shamefacedness and sobriety. Now, shamefacedness is this. Look what I've got on. You know what? Not wrong, pretty close. But if you're doing it to one-up somebody, the Lord's not pleased with you. Shamefacedness. You know, a lot about the Amish and Mennonite culture I don't agree with. 99% of their stuff doesn't have a root of Bible in it. But, do you know why they all wear the same style of clothes? Because nobody's jealous of the other person.
That's right.
Don't create that. Don't brew that up in them.
And so we see then that the first thing is that it's modest, and the second thing that concerning this that it's shamefaced. You don't come out with a prideful attitude. And the second thing, and this is, it says with sobriety. Now Matthew has rode with his policeman friend a couple of times, and sometimes they have sobriety checkpoints. They're looking for the drunks. They're looking for the people who are inebriated. They're looking for people that aren't on task when it comes to driving. With this reflection of the woman, it needs to be serious. You know, it needs to be, it needs to go with the rest of the picture. You know what, if you saw a picture of a person in a dress and, you know, maybe had a head covering on but had a beard like mine, it'd be a little confusing, wouldn't it? Like, well, you know, which one is that? It needs to be, the whole picture needs to be there. So, if they have their dress on and they look all so sweet, but they've got their mouth clenched like this, the picture's incomplete. That make sense? No sobriety. No seriousness. And so we see, as the Lord's people, it ought not to be so. So with shamefacedness, not with brooded, some people say plaited, some people say dyed. I've heard a lot of different things on that. Brooded hair, or gold, or pearls, or costly array. Now, let me say this, and I'm not going to delve too deeply because I don't understand as much of that as I probably should. You know what? If you're wearing that jewelry to one-up somebody, get it off. This little wedding band, and don't be impressed, it's not the one I started out with. But I'm too fat for that one to go on. But me and Donna got these for our 25th wedding anniversary several years, 4 years ago. I don't mind wearing that. But if somebody said, if it began to be an issue and began to be a point of contention, you know what the best thing for me to do? Is get it off and put it up. And just, you know, if it can't be done the right way, just get rid of it. Don't make it an issue of contention. And so we see then, as the Lord's people, it ought not to be so among the church. We don't want to strive up that jealousy. We don't want to strive up that problem within us. Verse 10. But, going back to dress, but what that which becometh women, professing godliness with good works. Now, what garment becometh, or is to be, or as unto, that's what becometh means. It is a being verb, is what we called it in elementary school. A being verb, like be, am, and is. It means that which pertains to. That which becometh women. Now, you'll think I'm crazy. Don't take no rocket scientist to go down to the McDonald's down here by the park. And maybe you don't read English real well to find which bathroom belongs to you, does it? Because you'll have a little thing on the door. Like, well, that one's in a dress. This one has on a pair of britches. I belong over here. Right? Pretty simple, isn't it? But now, we live in a day and age. You think the sodomites, the only reason that they're concerned about them bathrooms and getting a unisex one or transgender, whatever. You know what it is? In addition to being just a scathing slap in the face of God, they want one more nick, one more good punch at defining a man and a woman in the difference. That's really what it's about. That's really what it's about. And so we find then, and gentlemen, I want to say this with you and I, because again, Paul's letter to Timothy was very specific. And you know, everybody goes, why are we always down with the women? Well, this is the thing with that. You know what? It was written, so there must have been a problem. Right? But you know, I will say this, gentlemen, we don't need to run around in our short britches. Because you know what? It's not modest. That's the first thing we read about the woman, is it not? Nothing modest about showing your legs off to people. Nothing modest about running around with no shirt on. It ought not to be so. It's just as bad. It doesn't become of those professing godliness. We need to be a modest, separate people. And you say, well, we look like freaks, oh, blah, blah, blah. No, if you want the power of God, these are the type of things it's going to cost you if you want God to be with you. And if you're satisfied with an everyday routine, hey, that's fine. You go with it. But you know what? I'm tired of being satisfied with an everyday routine. Verse 15. Notwithstanding, she shall be saved in childbearing if they continue in faith and charity and holiness and sobriety. Now, certainly not a midwife, that's my wife's department, but I do know this. Holiness is not a denomination. That's that third characteristic we just read about. Continuing holiness. It's not Pentecostal people. It's a descriptor. The Bible says, be ye holy, for I am holy. That means separated. You know, that's the same word. It means set apart. It means different. Called out for a purpose. You be separated. You be holy. And if you are, the Bible says here, and ladies, I claim that verse, you be saved in childbearing if this is the case. One more place, and I promise I'm done. 1 Timothy again, this time chapter 5 and verse 8. 1 Timothy 5, verse 8. Gentlemen, but if any provide not for his own house, and especially for the... For if any man provide not for his own, and especially for those of his own house, he hath denied the faith, and he is worse than an infidel. You know what? I enjoy nursing, about the only thing I know how to do well. But if nursing fell out, the best thing I could do, I'd have to go find me a job digging a ditch, or working at a sawmill, or something that I could be accomplishing, because it's my responsibility.
Yeah.
I still have children at home, and it is my responsibility that these three young ladies have everything they need. It ain't President Trump's responsibility, it's mine. It ain't the state of Tennessee's responsibility, it's mine. And we are to get the job done. There are people that literally have been on... Families, I mean, that have been on welfare since the day of the Great Depression. 75 years. And the cycle still not be broken. We need to understand it is our responsibility. We need to get up and step to the plate. And listen, being raised in a one-parent home, I know what it is for a man who will not step up and do his job. Now, I want you to see the revealing. We talked about how these... revealing garments and looking so cheap in a woman. We see this is revealing in the man. You just lay around and never do nothing. The Bible says it's worse than an infidel. So the only conclusion that I can come to is men that do that, they must be lost. You say, well, Brother Larry, you're judging. No, I'm going with the Bible because the Bible says it's worse than an infidel. And you know where infidels wind up? They wind up in the middle and the pits of hell. That's where infidels wind up. And so they're worse off than them. And so we as the Lord's people, we need to be, that should be the very minimal of the things that we do is to be sure that our family is taken care of. Now, you also will notice here, we won't go into it too deeply, but it gives the qualifications for a woman to be taken under the financial care of the church. Not the financial care of the government, but the financial care of the church. But if it says something like this, but if she has no children.
You know what?
If my mom, you know who's responsible for being my mother?
You know who's responsible for my mother? Me and James Dale. It is our responsibility to see things are done for her. Now, if we were both gone and Judy's gone, then it would be the responsibility would then fall to my sons. But just say she never had children. Then it does fall to the church, but it's very, very specific. Remember when the Lord Jesus Christ, one of the last things he said, he said, "Woman, behold thy son." And then he looks at Peter and says, "Behold thy mother." Or John, excuse me. He said, "Behold thy mother." See, he was the oldest son, and in the Jewish faith, that woman, Mary, was his responsibility. And he passed it along. See, we wouldn't need no government handouts if that's the way we went by, would we? So men, we need to do the same thing. We need to look the same. We need to act the same. Well, we need to be a testimony. You want a powerhouse church? You find about 12 or 15 that will do that right there. And you're going to have a powerful church that means business for Christ.